Gotcha, yeah.
Okay. I assume everyone can hear me reasonably well.
That's good. My name's Gabe Buckley. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the National President of the Liberal Democratic Party. Normally I would have weaseled out of standing up here by delegating the MC duties to our Queensland President, Anne Kerr, but she's unfortunately been called away on business this evening, so is unable to join us, but I do want to thank Anne and also Mix Uplift for a large amount of organisational effort that's gone into putting this evening on, so I'd like to thank those guys. I've had the pleasure of being involved with the Queensland branch of the LDP for a little over 5 years now. Got involved not long after I moved up here. In that time, I've seen it grow from a very few number of members. I think when I started, we were languishing at about 250 members, and we've now grown to a point where pushing for state registration is actually a feasible proposition. I know I've been saying we hope to be registered in time for the next state election for the last two state elections, but this time I've got a reasonable degree of confidence that it might actually happen. Before it does happen, though, we will be getting another invite to the big dance. There'll be a federal election next year, and to that effect, we've put out the call for people to run as candidates. We hope to not only stand Senate candidates like we did last time, but also a number of lower house candidates. So if you've ever felt the need to have every aspect of your life picked over by the media, feel free to come up and see me, and I'll guide
here.
I'll guide you in the right direction. It's great, I've managed to piece together my entire 20s since. But it's going to be one of the best chances we've ever had to capitalise on the hard work of the men that you've all come out to see tonight. And David Leyonhjelm needs no introduction, but he always likes it when I give him one anyway. So since being elected in 2013 and taking his seat in July of 2014, he has been a constant thorn in the side of a lot of people that we like to annoy a great deal. He's been very good at applying his straight-up common-sense brand of political theory to pretty much everything that's come across his desk in Parliament, which is no mean feat in an organisation whose entire raison d'etre is to constrain people's liberties. So I think he deserves a significant commendation for being able to keep his cool and not tug out the last vestiges of hair that are clinging to his temples. He has been an enormous boon to freedom-loving people everywhere. His praise for marginalised groups of Australians, such as smokers, motorcyclists and shooters, has drawn the admiration of freedom-loving people across the country as much as it has drawn the ire of leftist ninnies who like to think we should all be governed according to their feelings. So without further ado, I'll introduce David, but I do have a small presentation to make. After the events on the weekend, and given that your next stop is Townsville, and they're not letting anybody through airport security unless they're properly attired. So on behalf of the Queensland branch, we'd like to present you with this North Queensland Cowboys symbol.
Purist. And I keep thinking to myself, you wait till we get Gabe elected. And we'll then discover what that is. Okay, can I ask, is this working all right?
Amazing.
Can I ask how many people here were at the ALS conference in Melbourne, in Sydney in May this year? Is there anybody? Yes, all right. And can I ask how many people here are members of the party? Okay, that's good. Right, I think with my subject matter. Just remind you of a little bit of history, if I can. Back in 2013, in September, in fact I remember the date really well because I had a hangover, we had a new government after the Rudd and Gillard fiasco. And prior to the election, we'd heard Tony Abbott say, I am going to amend Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act. So we all thought, okay, this was good. Abbott's election was going to be an unmitigated success. But he faced a hostile Senate at that time. There was a majority of Labor and Greens in the Senate. So then came July 2014, and I and a number of other crossbenchers were sworn in. So made 8 crossbench senators, and the government required 6 of these in order to get its legislation through when Labor and the Greens were against it. As a result of that, the government had some success. Carbon tax was repealed. The mining tax was repealed in September last year. The government managed to reintroduce temporary protection visas to help deal with the backlog of asylum-seeking people claiming asylum in Australia and in detention. It then introduced a raft of national security legislation and got those through because Labor lay down on those. And it failed in a number of important areas. Higher education, the GP co-payment, family tax benefit modifications, industrial relations reform are the main ones that would come to mind. Now, there are lots of reasons why that occurred, and some of them have to do with this poor relationship with the crossbench. I have gone public on that a number of occasions. The government's dealing with the crossbench was really quite abysmal, and they're a laughing stock from the Labor Party's point of view. The Labor Party is accustomed to schmoozing and negotiating. The Liberals think it's beneath their dignity to do that. So, only a couple really of the front bench ministers got their heads around it. The rest of them sort of held their nose and thought they were negotiating, but they really weren't. Then, so things started to go downhill for Tony Abbott's government. Well, late last year, really, the noises were starting to be heard. I obviously talked to a lot of people of the Liberal Party, mainly senators, and I knew that things weren't happy. Then it came to a spill motion in February this year. Nobody was very happy about that. The same-sex marriage issue came up, and Abbott fought that very hard. It resulted in the plebiscite decision. And it was obvious that that hadn't settled anything. And then the replacement came along about 3 weeks ago with Turnbull. I knew that that was likely to occur, or something along those lines was likely to occur, although I was wondering whether Scott Morrison might have a run. He had a lot of support amongst the more conservative area of the part of the Liberal Party. And I think that probably Turnbull supporters decided to get in first in case Turnbull did have a go. But I knew something was going to happen, and I was expecting it to happen within 2 weeks of the Canning by-election. And it caught me and everybody else by surprise when it occurred a few days before the Canning by-election. So now we have a new Prime Minister, and his reason for challenging Abbott was the economic narrative was being poorly communicated. In fact, I'd argue that I didn't even have one. And Turnbull is a communicator. He believes that he can bring the Australian public with him, convince them of the need for economic reform, and generally be more successful than Abbott has been. The chances are the Liberals were heading for a one-term defeat in the next election. I don't think they could have won with Abbott. A lot of people will disagree with that, especially the more conservative side of the Liberal Party. But the reason reason that Abbott got replaced by Turnbull was because there's some hard heads in the Liberal Party. They'd been doing their own polling, obviously. They'd come to the conclusion that the next election was unwinnable if Abbott remained in the chair. And my feeling now is that Turnbull will win this election, so we'll probably have a Liberal government for at least a second term. But looking at it, it was almost 2 years to the day the stories about Abbott missing out on a particular pension because he didn't make it for 2 full years is a load of bullshit. There's no truth in that at all. But he nearly, it was almost to the day, 2 years he was Prime Minister. And if we look at the record of the government during that period from a libertarian perspective, which is the point of view that I and the Liberal Democrats take to this, these circumstances, there's quite a lot that we can say that wasn't very good. I mentioned the back down on 18C. I was actually in the audience when Tony Abbott gave a commitment. It was at an IPA function in Sydney. He gave a commitment to say, we will amend to remove, insult and humiliate, insult and offend from 18C, the Racial Discrimination Act. They came under pressure. The nervous Nellies in the Western Sydney seats in particular came under pressure from, of all people, Muslims and Jews, plus a few others, of course, but they were very influential, both those groups. And rather than defend the decision to amend 18C, rather than fight the fight, the government folded. We then had the Section 35P of the ASIO Act, which prohibited reporting of essentially misconduct by ASIO, special intelligence operations. We had that before I screamed at the old. We also had a provision that exempted ASIO agents from being prosecuted for undertaking torture, but I managed to get that one removed. Advocating terrorism became an offence. Another national security bill had made it an offence to disclose, for journalists to disclose delayed notification warrants with 2 years in jail. So you have to get a warrant, you don't have to, the federal police don't have to notify, they've got a warrant to search your house. If a journalist reports, even after the event, it's all over, the journalist reports that delayed notification warrant existed, it's an offence with 2 years in jail. The government introduced what it calls an e-safety commissioner, which is a net nanny. It's a nanny to watch over your children on the internet to make sure they're not bullied. It's not your job anymore to protect them. It's the job of the e-safety commissioner. And little kids who engage in bullying on the internet can be come to the attention of the government, potentially face the coercive powers of the government. Little kids who complain that they are being bullied online don't need to run off to mum and dad and say, this nasty mad person is bullying me. They can run off to their e-safety commissioner. It's a dreadful intrusion into what is essentially a private matter, a family matter. We also had some poor economic decisions. The rejection of the takeover of GrainCorp by ADM was something that really offended me because of my agricultural background. Since then, we've seen GrainCorp close down rail terminals. Farmers have to transport their grain by road now to get it to rail. Farmers are the losers out of that decision, and yet the biggest proponents of that was the agrarian socialists in the National Party and their sympathisers. We had, as I mentioned, a failed economic narrative. There was no attempt, really, no serious attempt to convince Australians that we had a budget problem. In fairness, it wasn't the government's fault that there is a budget problem. They inherited it from the ridiculous spending attitudes of the Rudd and Gillard governments, and in particular, their stimulus from the GFC. Left us with a massive great deficit and an interest burden of releases and said things are crook. Then they shut up for the Western Australian Senate rerun. And then just a month after that, they brought out their first budget last year. And of course, their first budget was characterised by Labor, the Greens and much of the media as a horror budget, really harsh and really tough. In reality, it wasn't anywhere near as tough as the Commission of Audit had recommended, and the Commission of Audit's recommendations were not all that radical anyway. So it was nowhere near the draconian budget that it was characterised as, but the government hadn't even presented a narrative to sell it, let alone succeeded with that narrative. So of course the perception that it was a horror budget prevailed. They were absolutely appalling at convincing the Australian public of the need for any austerity. And I don't think the Australian public is stupid, but most Australians just get on with their life and don't pay much attention to these sort of things. Had the government said, we cannot keep spending more money than we're bringing in, which would you prefer, taxes to go up or spending to go down? I think they would have won that one fairly quickly. But they never even tried that one. Then the 2015 budget this year, they gave up trying. Said, no, we're not going to even try to balance the budget. And to the extent that there was any effort in that direction, was mostly cancelling tax concessions. So in other words, tax deductions, effectively tax increases. Reductions in expenditure are almost nowhere to be found. They even introduced the budget repair levy and to the extent that they sort of engaged in a narrative, they went along with this idea that tax increases are savings and reforms is a tax increase are the same thing. It was abysmal. So, in many respects, one of the nicest things about Malcolm Turnbull taking over as Prime Minister was the statements he made on the night that he challenged, arguing that we need a new economic narrative. So if he does nothing else but convince Australians that you can't keep living beyond your means, that will be potentially very constructive. But it wasn't all bad. There were some good things in the last 2 years. They ended subsidising the car industry, ended subsidies to the car industry, which was long overdue, of course, and attracted no end of screams, particularly from South Australia, and hence all the nonsense about building submarines in South Australia. But it was good, and they didn't agree to subsidise SPC, and they didn't agree to subsidise Qantas. So sometimes a decision not to do something is as good as you can get. The Union's Royal Commission has been a good decision overall. It was probably a bit unfortunate that Dyson Heydon decided to go and speak at a Liberal Party function, but...
only if you're a Liberal Party.
What the Union Royal Commission has exposed is what we all suspected was the case, is that the CFMEU is a thoroughly corrupt criminal organisation of a similar sort of ilk to the Painters and Dockers, if you're old enough to remember them, and the BLF, if you're old enough to remember them. I think probably they're not as bad as that in every state, but certainly in Victoria they are wicked. And the Union Royal Commission has exposed that. The other aspect that I think deserves commendation from the government has been the free trade agreements. And Andrew Robb, in some respects, is an unsung hero. He's had the agreements negotiated with China, Japan and Korea, and now the TPP on his watch. Now, admittedly, the bureaucrats do the bulk of the work, but it doesn't happen without the minister being right behind them, backing them up. So this credit, where credit is due. So that's the government. Now, fairly obviously, I'm only one of eight crossbench senators, and there is a limit to how much influence I can have. But it's surprising, every now and again, and I have learnt this by trial and error over the last year, it is surprising how often they need my vote. They really, really think it's important, and I really don't give a stuff. And it's not a, it's not a matter on which, you know, it's an LDP principle. And I'm able to say to them, okay, what am I going to get for my vote? Or what's that effect? And that has worked quite nicely in a few cases. So allow me to brag a little bit. In the this, not all of this is negotiated deals, of course, but in the first week, when the carbon tax was coming through, I managed to carve out one of the bills. It was a bundle of 8 bills to repeal the carbon tax. I managed to carve out one of those bills, which was a reversal of a tax concession, and it was worth $1.55 billion, and so that bill didn't get repealed, so we kept the tax concession. Now, unfortunately, the government since then has re-legislated that that change, so it only lasted a little while, but it annoyed the crap out of them for a while. I made a nuisance of myself over agricultural levies. My background is in agriculture, agribusiness, and I knew the agri levies system was corrupt and dreadful. So I made such a pest of myself that we set up a Senate inquiry. Inquiries are quite common in the Senate, and the outcome was, as I expected, everyone said, holy crap, look at this mess, we've got to fix it. So some recommendations were made which will hopefully fix it, although they have not been implemented yet, so I may have to use some of my leverage to give Barnaby another headache. The Greens set up an inquiry into illicit firearms, and it was intended essentially to prove that the source of illegal firearms, firearms used in crime, was legal firearm owners who didn't look after them properly. That was the intention. So I immediately assigned myself to that committee, sat in on all the hearings, every one of the hearings. Bridget McKenzie from the Nationals in Victoria was also there. We kind of ran a tag team. And we essentially beat up on all the witnesses who didn't like guns, questioned the ones who were from the shooting organisations, and exposed the fairy stories of the law enforcement organisations, and it basically fizzled out. It came to a position where there's no decent data on this. Nobody really knows the source of illegal guns. What data we have suggests that it's not legal owners who are the main source. It's most likely imports. And there is absolutely no case for any increase in regulation in that area. The Greens accused me of determining the outcome. They gave me some wonderful free publicity, calling me a manipulative person. I can't remember the exact words, but I was quite flattered. So obviously that's going nowhere. Although there are issues surrounding firearms that I'm working on. Another area that where leverage really did count was on the wind turbines inquiry. I'm opposed to renewable energy for the reason that it's subsidised. The cost of it is jacked onto all of our electricity bills. I'm not opposed to renewable energy if it's unsubsidised. But that's not the issue in this case, even though the renewable energy industry hates me with a passion, and they're always saying that I'm opposed to renewable energy. I am only opposed to subsidies. But what was going on is the wind industry was building their turbines far too close to residences, rural residences, farmhouses and so forth, and the very low frequency sound being emitted by the turbines was making people sick. The wind energy companies are very big, many of them multinational, a number of them are foreign owned, they are by no means just sort of koala-hugging greenie types. They are in it to make a buck. So, but nonetheless, the koala-hugging greenie types think that they are wonderful. So they get off scot-free. They build their turbines in the wrong place. They don't comply with their planning rules. They're not held to account because they are renewable, and there are lots of greenies who think they can do no wrong. They basically thumb their nose at all the sort of rules and regulations that every other industry has to comply with, plus the standards relating to sound emitted by wind farms are not fit for purpose anyway. They don't even include low frequency sound in their standards. So, you know, it's a very sorry mess. So I put up a proposal for a select committee into wind turbines. It was dominated by the crossbench, John Madigan, Bob Day, Nick Xenophon, plus one from Labor, one from the government. And it was hugely successful at highlighting the fact that there were problems. We put up some recommendations in an interim report, and it just coincided, a couple of weeks after we did the interim report, it coincided with the government needing our vote to include biomass in the renewable energy target legislation. The Labor Party had moved an amendment to the renewable energy target bill to exclude biomass, and the government had given a promise to the Forest Products Association to bring biomass in, to include biomass in renewable energy, along with, say, hydro and solar and wind and so forth. So we said, okay, here's something you really, really want. This gives us a bit of leverage. We'll vote down in Labor on this unless you give us what we want. We didn't trust Greg Hunt. Greg Hunt's a believer, put it that way. He doesn't mind wind energy and the fact that it's subsidised because he thinks it's saving the world from climate change. So we went to the Prime Minister, Mrs. Abbott. Abbott was on record as saying he hates wind turbines, so we knew we were starting from a fairly solid ground. We said, you want biomass, we want what we want, and it worked. We got what we wanted. The Greens and Labor howled their heads off. Well, half of Labor secretly agreed with us, the other half didn't. But the Greens howled their heads off. In fact, unforgivably called me stupid. I could put up with disagreement, but I don't like ad hom, so on this, the Greens are several levels down from where we started from. Anyway, the end result was we got the Wind Farm Commissioner, we got the Expert Advisory Committee. Will in time make a difference to the suffering that people are enduring who live near these wind farms. As I mentioned, the torture issue, George Brandis, the Attorney General, was for a couple of weeks saying, no, poor little David, Senator Leyonhjelm, doesn't know what he's talking about. There's no provision in this ASIO Act, amendment to the ASIO Act, that would enable torture. And so at the beginning, I was a lone voice. But after a while, a few others started chiming in, including Brett Walker. And he said, yeah, actually, I think he's got a point. And George kept saying, no. I'm not going to do anything with it because there's no risk here. And he said, it's inconceivable, and besides, Australian ASIO agents would never do such a thing, which didn't actually mean they couldn't if they wanted to, it just means they're too nice to do that sort of thing. So I eventually went on the TV and said, all cooperation ceases unless this is fixed, and lo and behold, it was fixed. Bob Day has introduced a bill very much the same as what Tony Abbott said he was going to do. In fact, I think it's the same as what was tabled in the House of Reps, but not put through, removing offend and insult from the agency of the Racial Discrimination Act. But only the Greens joined me in opposing the anti-free speech provisions in the national security legislation. So, bit of a lonely battle, that one, and they oppose amending 18C. So free speech has really not had a consistent supporter in the 2 years in which I've been in the Senate. I've been the only one really who's held a candle for free speech on every occasion. But it's not all bad. Malabar Rifle Range in Sydney is a huge rifle range. It caters for tens of thousands of shooters. The previous government had been working very hard to chuck the shooters off with nowhere else to go. It would have been devastating for the shooting sports. I lobbied the government on that, and thankfully the responsible minister, who is Matthias Cormann, was sympathetic. He was also very grateful to me for having voted with the government to repeal the carbon tax and mining tax. So we now have a process not quite there yet, the lease is still being negotiated, but shooters will have permanent long-term lease at Malabar Rifle Range as a result of that. On the issue of temporary protection visas, I said there was some negotiation about that. That really got quite interesting because Scott Morrison learnt on the job how to negotiate with the crossbench. At the beginning of the process, he was funny. His idea was to tell us what he wanted, and he'd deal with us individually. He was dealing with me individually. I think he might have dealt with the pups as a group to begin with anyway. And when I said, oh, look, I've got a few ideas of my own, his solution to that, or his response to that, was just to tell me what he wanted again, only don't say it a bit louder if I didn't speak English. So, but after a while, he got to the point where he realised he needed my vote, really, and he needed to start listening. It was, to his credit, at the beginning, he was like all the other Libs, didn't really want to deal with us scruffy crossbenchers, didn't think we had any ideas of our own, and just a matter of telling us until we got it. By the end of it, it was, okay, what do you want? What do you want to see come out of this? What do I have to do to get your vote? So as a result, Clive got what's shared, Safe Harbour Enterprise Visas, which are one of the best ideas Clive's ever had. There aren't many. Some of these hitherto illegal immigrants get granted permanent residence on the grounds that they live in a regional area. Work, and if they stay here and work long enough, they have a path to permanent residence and ultimately citizenship. We got an increase in the refugee intake, which we wanted. And a couple of us were seeking that. My view is that that's the right thing to do. We're much better off spending our money on accepting genuine refugees than we are on wasting it on foreign aid. And we got an inquiry by the Productivity Commission into our immigration policy. Those of you who are party members and have looked at our policies will know that our immigration policy is based on the work of the Nobel Prize winner, Gary Becker, who said we should sell permanent residence. He recommended it for America and for the UK, and we think it would work quite well here in Australia as well. So we've got a Productivity Commission inquiry into that policy. And that would not have happened but for the fact that I blackmailed Scott Morrison into agreeing to it in exchange for supporting temporary protection visas, which I didn't think very much of, but I didn't see it as a major principle. The Greens have introduced a bill to allow medical marijuana. I have co-sponsored that along with a number of other senators. It's not going to get up. I don't think. Highly regulatory, way too regulated for my liking. More or less a compassionate thing. There are sick people who need medical marijuana and they can't get it at the moment. What it does do, though, is allow me to talk about how silly it is that we are thinking about regulating the crap out of medical marijuana when the easiest thing to do would be to legalise recreational marijuana and allow the medical developments to occur much less inhibited. I often point out that three American states have already legalized marijuana for recreational use, and we are very much behind the eight ball because we haven't even approved medical marijuana. And nobody else in the federal parliament, at least, will even discuss that. When I do press conferences with the other co-sponsors on this issue, I'm the only one prepared to talk about recreational marijuana. It is utterly ridiculous. Anyway, my freedom to marry bill, the same-sex marriage bill, I knew that would never succeed, but I did it for a number of reasons. Number one was I don't see same-sex marriage as an equality thing or a discrimination thing. I see it as a matter of getting the government out of your private life. It's a basic fundamental of classical liberalism. Just as the government shouldn't black people or white people, if we're black, or Jews can't marry Gentiles, and Catholics can't marry Protestants. And wasn't that long ago in Australia when Catholics and Protestants getting married was known as a mixed marriage? Wasn't that long ago? So we wouldn't countenance that sort of thing these days, but we still allow the government to tell us what gender a person we can marry. So we're not sure we allow it, and we have the government telling us. So I pitched it in those terms, and my freedom to marry bill was pitched as a deregulatory proposition. We also gave a carve out for civil celebrants to not be obliged to marry anyone if they didn't want to. And as a result, I knew it would never succeed, but I was hoping to influence the debate. And that worked. And there were quite a number of Liberal Party senators, and I think some members as well, members of the House of Reps, who saw my arguments and said, okay, now I get it, and weren't willing to support it from an equality or a discrimination point of view. They were willing to support it on the grounds of deregulation. So it influenced the debate. Now, it also allowed me to get airtime, if you like, on the ABC and in Fairfax. When you talk about shooters' rights, low taxes, less expenditure, you have to be a right-wing nut job. But if you talk about all those things and same-sex marriage and legalising marijuana, you can't possibly be a right-wing nut job. So it served that purpose as well. And I do intend in the next 12 months to also bring on assisted suicide. And you can't, of course, be a right-wing nut job if you're supporting assisted suicide either. So it is quite important not to be a right-wing nut job, because it closes off a whole lot of media options for me. So I need to keep the door open. The Adler ban, yes. Now, the Adler ban was a classic example of blackmailing the government. It was really quite fun. the Adler ban was gathering momentum, and the government had announced it, and then we found that a regulation had been introduced by Peter Dutton, because he's the customs minister, wasn't Keenan, who's the Justice Minister, even though he drove it. And they had said it was a temporary ban. The announcement was it was a temporary ban pending a review of the National Firearms Agreement. Well, the Adler shotgun, the only thing different about it is that the magazine capacity is a little bit larger than what the other lever-action shotguns are that have been imported. There are already two or three brands of lever-action shotguns with five-round magazines being imported. They've been brought in for years and years. And the only difference was this one had, I think, seven-round plus one in the spout, something like that. And it was, you know, blown up out of all proportion, but it created a moral panic. Keenan decided that all the police ministers were calling for it to be prohibited, which wasn't true, and we found that out. And told Abbott, and Abbott said, oh, beauty, a national security issue. Just imagine if a Muzzy terrorist gets a hold of an Adler, they'll kill 8 people instead of 5. And so it was, you know, I could see where this was heading. So the government wanted my support to oppose a Labor amendment to something to do with immigration. Labor had an amendment which would have required 2 people to be present when minors and women were searched or something like that, collecting biometric data, that's what it was. The law already requires a woman to be present when women are, for women, a responsible person or something like that for children, but Labor wanted to double all that. The government was seriously opposed to it. I couldn't see any arguments on either side that were really all that substantial. So I said to Dutton, well, you want our support on that, then you're going to have to put a 12-month sunset clause on the Adler ban regulation, because that's what you said you were going to do. And so you should actually do what you said you're going to do, and then we'll vote with you instead of with Labor on this amendment. Dutton is one of the least user-friendly ministers that I have to deal with. He didn't take it well, if I can put it that way. It was quite a bit of fun. And, Bob Day is a friend of mine. He and I agree on a lot of stuff, especially economic stuff. We work together because it's a lonely place in the Senate by yourself. If you don't have friends, it can be a tough time. Jackie's discovering that too. So I went up to Bob's office and explained what I was doing. He said, no problem, it's fine. I don't know much about guns, but I'll support you on this. And I support him on IR stuff without really thinking much about it, because I know he knows a lot more about it than I do. So it works very well for both of us. Anyway, we were sitting there having a chat, and I told him what the discussion I'd had with Dutton in his office, and he said, oh, he's been ringing here as well, harassing the crap out of us. It's really annoying. And then the next thing you know, one of Bob's advisors comes into the office. Bob and I are just sitting there chatting about it. He said, Dutton's on his way over. So we said, oh, that'll be fun. And so 15 minutes later, in walks Dutton, thinks he's only going to see Bob, and sees me sitting there talking to Bob. His face dropped about 10 feet. And, so we had a free and frank exchange, and as a result, the Adler ban has got a sunset clause on it for 12 months, and the Keenan, the Minister for Justice, is meeting nominated shooting organisations, as he said he was when I met him, but we discovered it was bullshit. He is now. So that was a little bit of leverage. the Nanny State Inquiry, interestingly enough, that was a suggestion by the Labor Party. Of course, I didn't need to be convinced about that one. It is the gift that keeps on giving. We set a very long reporting date. We're going to have interim reports. We've nominated six topics, I think, in the terms of reference, plus F is any other matter, and there will be lots of other matters. The purpose of these sorts of inquiries is not necessarily to change government legislation. Most of the nanny state stuff is subject to state jurisdiction. So the idea is that we just expose it, embarrass state governments, embarrass the authorities involved, put out an interim report, which is fairly easy reading, and then move on to the next topic. So we're going to look at bicycle helmets and marijuana and classification of video games, service of alcohol, including lockouts. We're going to have a look at lockouts in Brisbane as well. I can't remember now, several other things. And of course we're getting pressured and encouraged to look at other things. And almost everybody in the media has got at least one nanny state issue that really bugs them. And it's quite an entertaining exercise to get them talking about the one that bugs them and then start bringing other ones into it as well. And they have a certain amount of difficulty joining the dots, but you know, you hope that sooner or later the penny will drop and they will realise it's not just that issue, that there's a whole series of issues. So that really is going to define my relationship with the media, I think, probably for the next 9 months. This nanny state inquiry. And I have an excellent ally in Sam Dastyari. Sam is a lovable rogue. And he will publicly protest that he thinks some of the nanny state rules are okay, but in private he hates them. So it's a good team, and he's quite an asset, really. The other inquiry I'm involved with is the Murray-Darling Basin implementation plan. Now that's really to help out John Madigan. John Madigan was very closely aligned with Nick Xenophon. I think Xenophon votes for the Greens more often than Labor, really, I think. Prizing John away from Nick is handy because it gives the potential for a crossbench deal with Nick left out of it, you know, greater scope. So that was useful. There are also some issues with the Murray-Darling Basin plan, with country towns being decimated by loss of water, businesses that supply the farming communities suffering badly when they had no involvement in the sale of water rights. There are some farms that have lost their water rights involuntarily. There are some farms that are being flooded, so their land is unproductive involuntarily. And then when you talk to the bureaucrats, the Murray-Darling Basin Authority and the Department of Environment and so forth, it's all going swimmingly well. No, there are no problems. Everybody who's unhappy about it is just grizzling for no good reason. So obviously this is fertile territory for us to come up with examples of where they're wrong and expose the fact that there are people, you know, that are being put out of business or their businesses being harmed due to government action, not due to their own incompetence. They're the kind of people that I actually like to help. So that's sort of a list of things that I regard as not necessarily achievements, but things on which I've made some progress. Now, I just want to talk a little bit about the relationship with the government now that Malcolm Turnbull is in charge, and also where does that leave us, the Liberal Democrats? Malcolm Turnbull is a nice guy. I get on very well with him. He's a utter bullshit artist, but in a nice way. Nowhere near is that unusual in Parliament House. Lots of bullshit artists. So he has. He and I have had many chats before he was Prime Minister. We've only had two since he became Prime Minister. And he tells me that he's the second most libertarian person in Parliament House. Obviously, after me. I nearly said to him, pull the other one and play Jingle Bells, but it's, you know, at least he's trying. You can't blame, it's way more than Abbott ever did. I think I've only ever met Abbott four times, ever, and he didn't try very hard at all. So it's good that at least he understands that he needs to get on side with the crossbench. Now, I think it's probably true to say that Malcolm is more liberal than Abbott was, liberal in the small liberal sense. But it's important to understand that the Liberal Party is really, at minimum, two quite distinct ways of viewing the world. They overlap a reasonable amount on economic issues, although there's still a very strong tendency in the Liberal Party to argue that they're better at spending other people's money than the Labor Party is. And questioning whether to spend the money in the first place doesn't come up as often as it ought to. But I think it helps to consider the Liberal Party as having a conservative element and a liberal, smaller liberal element to it. And they are in sort of a semi-undeclared war. So Abbott represented the conservative wing and Turnbull belongs in the liberal wing. They don't like each other very much, but it turns out there's only certain issues that they fight over. Same-sex marriage is a biggie. It really is a biggie. They think Turnbull is an enthusiastic like Greg Hunt for climate change stuff. He used to be, that's true. I don't know whether he still is. We haven't heard anything from him on that subject since he was made Prime Minister. If that's the case, that'll be disappointing, of course. Although he can believe in it all he likes. If his attitude is, we're not going to do anything, or we're not going to do anything more than what we're already doing, which is quite a possibility, then perhaps that's not so bad. But it is important to understand what Malcolm does should be interpreted through the matrix of the fact that he's got people within his own party who hate him and want to kill him. He's got people outside the party who hate him and want to kill him, and the Andrew Bolts of the world, those sort of people are in that camp. And then he's got a relatively enthusiastic mob of smaller Liberals around him as well, plus some Conservatives who he's kept on in his ministry. So he's juggling all that. That's only on his own side. That's not even accounting for the fact that he's also dealing with Labor and the Greens. So it's quite a job, and frankly, I don't envy him trying to juggle it all. But he is a schmoozer. He'll talk your leg off. He is certainly going to be better at handling the media than Abbott ever was. The same-sex marriage issue is interesting where it's ended up. The National Party's strongly opposed to same-sex marriage, so a day or two after Abbott was sworn in, they had a meeting with him. They don't trust him, so they insisted on a deal in writing. One of the things was that he wouldn't touch the plebiscite agreement that came out of the combined party room, as you will recall. So what that means is we are going to get a plebiscite on same-sex marriage. The timing of it, I'm not sure. The assumption is it'll be after the election, but I rather think there's a good argument for having it at the same time as the election and saving some money, so we'll see how that goes. Anyway, my take on it is that I think the Australian public will vote for same-sex marriage, at least 60%, could easily be 70%. I don't think we're any more conservative on this issue than Ireland, and Ireland was overwhelming. So I think the plebiscite will be positive. If there was no plebiscite, if it had been brought into the Parliament, I don't think it would have got through the House of Reps. It might have got through the Senate, just, but I'm pretty sure it would not have got through the House of Reps. So it would have, if they brought it on into Parliament, as many thought should have occurred, I think it would have failed anyway. So the plebiscite is likely to be passed, I think, even to referendum standards, a majority of people in a majority of states, in which case, the question is, what would have happened if Abbott had remained Prime Minister? I think he would have found a way in which to ensure it never got legislated. Turnbull, that won't happen. So for those people who support same-sex marriage, I think what's happened may be fortuitous. It may actually bring it to Australia faster than it would have occurred otherwise. There is a review into Section 35P of the ASIO Act, the one that I mentioned earlier, that's good. It's an important free speech issue affecting the media in particular, and it's good at least that the media has finally woken up to the fact that getting hobbled is not something they should just cop. They have been pretty pathetic on that. I doubt very much if we're going to cop any more national security legislation from Malcolm either. It was starting to get to the highly liberal stage. Abbott was determined to ban Hizbut Tahrir one way or another, and he was just going to construct a law that allowed him to ban them. I think the government will emphasise budget matters, economic matters, because that's the only thing that they will agree on in the Liberals, spending restraint. They might have a crack at IR prior to the election. They failed with the reinstatement of the ABCC, Australian Building Construction Commission legislation, by just one vote, and the Registered Organisations legislation failed by just one vote. I think bringing them back in again with schmoozing by Turnbull might change that. And I think there's going to be an emphasis on better communication narratives, if you like. That has the potential to influence Senate votes on higher education, with Simon Birmingham now in charge, and social welfare. Scott Morrison was making progress on social welfare. New minister, I can't remember who it is now. If they go about it the right way, they might make some progress there, although it's hard to say. So where does that leave all that leave the Liberal Democrats? Obviously, the more illiberal the government was, the more scope I had to talk about it, describe what a bunch of fascists they were and all that kind of stuff. And to some extent, I have lost the ability to rage against the government, because anyone who criticised Abbott, even if it was from a small government perspective, was given oxygen by the anti-Abbott people in Fairfax and ABC. So they're all in love with Turnbull for the time being. I don't think that'll last. But So even if I want to criticise Turnbull now, I won't get as much of a run as I did when I bagged Abbott. But nonetheless, I still think there's still going to be plenty of scope. At the moment, it's just honeymoon period. He hasn't made a single decision of any moment in the 3 weeks he's been Prime Minister. So once he starts making decisions, that will be the opportunity then to agree or disagree in public. I have to keep doing that. That's my job. My KPIs are win more seats, win more Senate seats at the next election. My success is not determined by being on TV or column inches or any of that sort of stuff. My success is getting people to vote for the Liberal Democrats in the next election enough that we win more Senate seats. Our objective is one senator in each state, each election. Now, if we did that, that would end up as 12 senators. 12 senators would give us the balance of power. You can imagine saying to the government, okay, now tell us we can't cut taxes. Which piece of legislation do you really want passed without our support? It would be tricky for them. So that's the objective. Now, do we like the Liberals? Are we going to support the Liberals? That's a hard question at the moment because they're suing us. They are taking legal action in the AAT over our name. They don't want us to have Liberal in our name. And of course, we reckon we've got a greater right to the word Liberal in our name than they have, because we are actually Liberal and they're not. So it's getting to the point where it's starting to be expensive. We've hired Brett Walker as our council, senior council. His cost is $15,000 a day. And we've got better things to do with our money than that. Now, I'm leaning on Turnbull and other ministers to say this is not good. It's not going to prove anything. It's going to cost us both money. And in the end, I don't think it'll win anyway. And I'm reasonably comfortable that our case is strong. So, and I'm hopeful that with Loughnane gone and Abbott gone, that the impetus for the case will disappear. But it hasn't happened yet, and I'm still applying the pressure. That has a huge impact, of course, on our preferences. If we're friends with the Liberals, we can talk to them about preferences. If we're in court against each other, then that makes it much more difficult. A lot of people couldn't get their head around that in the Canning by-election when we preferenced Labor ahead of the Liberals. People said, but, you know, the Liberals are naturally closer to us, except I made the point that in a couple of interviews, friends do not sue their friends. They're not friends if they're suing us. So philosophy is one thing, but suing you is another one. But it's not just the Liberals who are where preferences are relevant. The Labor Party is also going through a bit of a difficult time trying to decide whether they really want to stay in a sort of an embrace with the Greens. The argument is that the historical argument has been the Greens will preference them in lower house seats, they will preference the Greens in the upper house, and you know, look out for each other. The question, of course, is that if they didn't preference the Greens in the upper house, well, they'll always preference them before the Liberals, but what about before the Liberal Democratic Party? That's a more difficult thing. And they're going through that argument now. Some in the Labor Party are quite comfortable with the Greens and are happy to see any arrangements that keep the Greens preferencing them in the lower house seats. Though my argument is you don't have to do a deal to get that. The Greens voters have got nowhere else to go anyway. I'm not going to vote Liberal most of them. So, on the other side are those who hate the Greens, in the Labor Party, who hate the Greens because the Greens are just eating away at their voter base, stealing them from the left wing. So that's an interesting debate going on, and it's not out of the question that we might end up being preferenced by both the Liberals and Labor. And I'm working on that. And then that, of course, doesn't rule out the possibility of minor party preferences, which is what got us so close last time and got me over the line. Minor party preferences are, you know, very crucial. If the minor parties all stick together, preference each other, you know, we can get well over a quota quite easily. And of course, the relationship with Family First, Bob Day and Dio Wang from the pub, is strong. Dear old Clive still wants to be a player, so preferences from those two are an option as well. Financially, we're still doing well as a result of the $1 million we got when I got elected. We've still got about 800 and something thousand left, so we're not doing too badly on that front. I recently employed my sixth person in my office, Austin Erickson. Many of you would know Austin, I think, from Liberty on the Rocks and so on. He's quite an asset. Unfortunately, we've only got him 2 days a week. But he's not working on policy or any of that sort of stuff, which all my other staff are involved in to some extent. He's involved in party activities, relationships with other parties, and getting the organisational side of things going. It would be true to say that we've let that side slip a bit. The problem was that I was the main person to run the party from an administrative point of view, and then I got elected, and it turns out that we need about three people to replace what I was doing. So I'm hoping that Eric will really smarten up our relationship with our members, relationship with other parties, and just generally help you guys get registered and do things, get, you know, make your presence felt, and you know, generally make the Liberal Democratic Party more well known. That's, from Queensland's point of view, the issue is not winning seats in the Queensland state elections, because as you know, there's no upper house, that's pretty tough, but you can win quite a lot of votes. There are by-elections, and of course, the more you run in elections up here, doesn't matter whether they're state or federal, or local government for that matter, the more the party gets known, and then when we do run in winnable situations, primarily the Senate for the foreseeable future, there'll be more people who look on the ballot paper and go, oh yes, I know those kinds. So that's quite important. When will the next election be? If they hold it before July next year, it has to be a double dissolution. They do have one trigger for a double dissolution, but it's only the abolition of the Clean Energy Finance Corporation, which I don't know that Turnbull's all that committed to, given his history of support for climate change activity. So I'm not sure they'd use that as a trigger. They may bring back the IR bills as a form of trigger from that, but still to be seen. So if we're going to have an election, it'll be after July, 1st of July next year, probably August would be the earliest, assuming it's a normal half Senate and House of Reps. I actually suspect that unless something bad happens, they may go right through until September or October next year. Turnbull, I suspect, is going to like being Prime Minister. I don't think he'll be in a hurry to give it up. And I rather think he will enjoy it for as long as he can, unless it starts all turning sour. I think I might stop there. If you have any questions or you're dry, give you a chance to think of your questions and get a drink at the same time.
So if anybody does have questions, feel free to raise your hand and start on the left.
Yes, when we're talking about rights, like for instance to the nanny state inquiry, the response that we get from a lot of people is that it'll all be very well if people took responsibility for Beach when they go wrong, but it ultimately costs us in terms of healthcare costs and the like. And I guess I guess politically it's harder to talk about responsibilities than it is about rights. Joe Hockey tried it with the age of entitlement is over, it wasn't very popular. So I'm just wondering, how do you go about addressing that question in a way that is palatable to people?
Well, several ways. The you're going to cost us all money because we've got a socialised health system is the most common one. So you go and fall off a bicycle, bash your head open, you're going to end up costing me money through my Medicare levy or my taxes or something like that. That's a common one. The way I deal with that is to argue, well, look, other countries don't have socialised health systems, so that's a choice we make. We could be like Singapore, for example, and have health savings accounts, and where we are largely responsible for our own health insurance via health savings accounts, so it's a compulsory saving. And then it's a matter of you and your insurer. If your insurer decides that not wearing a helmet is a major risk, then you'll pay a higher premium. The other argument that I find more saleable, if you like, is say, well, where does that end? Do you want the law saying you're not allowed to eat chips? Do you want the law saying you're allowed 1.5 drinks but not 2? We've deemed 2 too much. Do you want the law saying you must exercise for 45 minutes 3 times a week? Because that's what the experts decide is what you need to do to lose weight or whatever it is, or avoid obesity. So the thin end of the wedge argument is the one that I use quite a lot. Rights versus responsibilities, I don't touch that other than to say adults don't need to be told how to live their lives. Children do, and so it's appropriate for the government to occasionally intrude into things affecting children, child abuse, for example. But it's not okay to do that to adults. Adults are capable of making choices for themselves. I haven't yet met anybody capable of making a better decision about somebody else than that person themselves. That's how I do it. And I don't get much pushback on that.
Dan?
Dan Van Boren. Tomorrow when you're winging your way north, you'll be flying over the Whitsunday area and north of Victoria. It's been in recession for the last couple of years due to the Greens and environmental organizations with their government money and tax dodges, keeping all these projects stopped and tied up in court. It's really hurting people along the coast and inland. I believe there was a review into those organizations. I was wondering if you knew any where that had got to. My other question was about the early election, which I think you covered quite well. It's mainly about what do you see as happening with those environmental organizations and how they're stopping our
some investigations going on into the tax deductibility status of some of those environmental organisations. The whole question of what you have to do to qualify for tax deductibility is really up in the air, and it's been driven, in fairness, by the Nationals in Queensland. Senator Matt Canavan from Queensland is really quite a good guy for Matt, especially. By no means a libertarian, but he has a healthy scepticism of government at times. So he's doing what he can to cut off the tax deductibility of some of the most egregious green groups, the ones that are really doing the most damage. It's a long list of them, that's the trouble. And then the government has reacted to the Adani law case by proposing to amend the EPBC, Environmental Protection and Biodiversity, something.
Every poor bastard is confused, that's what we call it.
Yeah. And it's, I actually don't think it's going to proceed, that legislation, though. I think that's one of the decisions that Turnbull has made, is let's not go picking a fight with that. So in a way, it's a bit of a shame, because it's the only act in the Australian Book of Laws where there's a provision that gives standing, by which it means anybody, someone who's allowed to present themselves to a court and argue in the case, that almost anybody who claimed to have an interest in it is granted standing in this particular act. Now, every other act in the Commonwealth law books, you have to have a direct material interest in it to get standing. So the government was proposing to amend the EPBC legislation to remove that standing and have it revert back to the common law situation. It applies to all the other acts. It caused a giant fuss, and I think Turnbull has decided he doesn't really need to fight over that. Brandis wants to do it, I know. But so it will be interesting to see where that ends up. I have a feeling that it's probably not going to be resuscitated until there's a new parliament and possibly the Senate is more sympathetic to it. And in the meantime, though, what I'm hoping is that there will be some green projects that will be seeking approval under the EPBC Act, and there will be some opponents who have no direct interest in it, who will nonetheless claim standing under the Act to intrude, and they will hold those green projects up, such as wind turbines farms. And I'm kind of hoping that there will be something that shows to the green groups that have been using this provision what goes around comes around. But in the meantime, nothing's going to happen.
Senator, is there any chance on any
Senator
Zoom on data retention? If so, is there any potential to work with Senator Woodland, as horrible as that might be?
Well, Scott's probably the least offensive of the Greens. He has some libertarian inclinations, although they're a bit subdued at times. I get on fairly well with Scott. Malcolm doesn't like data retention. He thought it was a load of crap when it was coming through, but he was out of the loop pretty much. There's a mountain of practical issues still to be dealt with on that. Who's going to pay? Where will the data be stored? The sort of the regulatory access regime. Quite a lot of issues to be dealt with, and they are really knotty little issues. You know, are they really going to make ISPs store it in Australia, which will be expensive? Or are they going to store it in the cloud, in which case the servers will be in China, most likely, because it's cheapest. How are they going to satisfy, well, some especially smart-ass bastards like me, that it's never going to be invaded, hacked, and all our metadata spread all over the internet. It'll be a gift that keeps giving for quite a while yet. So, but where it will end up, I don't know. I doubt now that it's legislated, the government backed it so hard, I doubt the government will back off, but it might modify it in a few ways. But I'd be surprised if we'd be able to kill it entirely.
First major breach might have some impact.
Yeah, I'm expecting it. There will be some tweaking which will go some way to protecting privacy and so forth. But I don't think, you know, the broad thrust of it is likely to be able to beat that.
Take a couple more and then we'll let David get a drink. So, and then Kelly.
Senator, thank you very much for your input about the shotgun. As a shooter, that was myself and several hundred of my friends jumping up and down. With regards to our current firearms laws and the restrictions that are placed on us, all 800,000 and those restrictions vary from state to state, is there any chance of getting some, I said, federal laws for each state? And is there any way to get some sort of Royal Commission or something into the Port Arthur shooting and the effectiveness of the laws enacted afterwards, but with the potential of repealing some of the more restrictive of those?
Well, the National Firearms Agreement is under review. I think I have successfully whipped up sufficient of a storm that what bureaucrats were intending to do won't occur. That is to move pump action and lever action long arms into category C and D. That's what the agenda was. So I think we might head that off. I don't know that we'll retrieve the Adler 8 shot, 7 or 8 shot, whatever it is. We may be stuck with that being in category C at the very least. But I think we'll keep 5 shots and below in either A or B category. Port Arthur Royal Commission, not a chance of that. A more holistic, more rational look at our gun laws relative to in relation to their effectiveness, that sort of thing. That would be nice. Not in the current environment. The government doesn't want to take that on. What I'm hoping, though, is that rather than have what you said was national laws for each state, what I would like to see is for this national government to get out of that space and basically leave it to the states as it was before 96, so that the states and then. Well, what we have is competitive federalism, so one state will be more restrictive, one state will be less restrictive. Which has a better outcome? We know the answer. Over time, you've got a better chance of leverage in the state governments than you have in the federal government. So if I can convince the federal government for no reason other than unnecessary intrusion into a state's rights issue and it's costing money, and therefore the National Firearms Agreement can be safely abandoned and left to the states, there may be some residual action such as data sharing, registration numbers shared between states, all that kind of stuff, and of course crime statistics. But beyond that, I think there is a realistic possibility that we might eventually convince the feds that this is an unwarranted intrusion into states. That's the best I can hope for, I think, at the federal level.
Kelly. Hello, thank you for the talk tonight. My name's Kelly. I have a kind of semi-pronged question for you. But before that, I thought I'd just like to introduce myself. I'm a UQ student, and I've been working with Thomas and the membership who have drafted the constitution, which we submitted to try and get a Liberal Democratic Club started at UQ. It was rejected on the basis of inclusivity, which was a bit silly, because I'm sure there were lots of other clubs that kind of specified that they're really about certain causes. So we had to amend it and make it more general. And I'd just like to make a call out to the UQ students I see here today. If all of us can, because it was rejected, they've said to us, we now need to get all the signatures again, which is just ridiculous. But I see at least 5 UQ members who signed here. If we can all meet up sometime next week and just get 5 other people we know to sign, we'll be able to do it and submit it again and correctly get stuff going. That's our intention, because we want to get, a club that can talk about these kind of issues happening on campus. So, yeah.
Just wait till you have to deal with the Electoral Commission.
I worked for them for a week before I was a member, so I don't have to worry, actually. I'm just very cold.
But can I give a note of encouragement to you? We have a history of students saying, let's form a Liberal Democrats club on campus, and then it's all dis- disappearing in a beer, bottom of a beer glass in a pub somewhere.
Well,
and,
yeah, there's an issue. Students don't want to become engaged in talks like that. But, I mean, we've got five or six of us here who I know are passionate tonight.
Yeah.
And even if we're the executive,
if you get it going,
yeah,
you will probably write the book on how to keep it going, too. That's pretty good. Now, you would also set a good example to the Queensland branch of the Liberal Democratic Party, which has not succeeded in doing that very well.
Some of them should more remember.
But whichever one gets registered first, will you attend their first function?
Well,
yes.
I did help grow one organisation at the uni from 300 people to over 1,300 in 2 years. So I've done
good.
That. But my question, first I had a comment on your equal marriage bill that you propositioned, and I have been going through in my head, I think it's an excellent, excellent bill, because the problems we see in the US then is that freedom of religion is then being encroached on, because we've got, but when you said that celebrants now will have a choice whether they want to, that essentially solves that issue. If one thing that really got to me recently.